Men, and good morning, friends. It's quite festive in here today. We're having good Christmas music. As you can see, Kate Thompson did an outstanding job of decorating the chancel, and I know she's on right now, so thank you, Kate, very much for that. The only thing that's missing is you all. But knowing you are here in digital form, knowing you're present with us in some fashion, that is definitely enough. Blessings to you, friends, and welcome to Trinity United Methodist this morning. My name is Bryson. For those of you who are fresh to the feed, welcome especially. Got plenty going on. Even though we're not physically together, we got a lot of Christmas stuff on tap. Here's a small slice. So first thing to note, this Wednesday at 7 p.m., we are rebroadcasting our cantata that we recorded back in 2015. It's called A Shepherd's Tale, and Brian Walls is putting his finishing touches on it this week, and I shall have the link out to you probably around maybe late Monday, early Tuesday. So look for it in your email. It will also be posted on our Facebook page. So if you're missing Christmas music, if you want a little sense of normalcy in your holiday, stop on by our YouTube channel, which you're on right now, at 7 p.m. Wednesday. All right, continuing on. Operation Turkey, the next iteration, will start or renew itself this coming Saturday, the 12th, from 9 to noon out in the parking lot. So we are taking canned goods, we are taking donations for HNS, and another group is going to be taking donations as well, and I have their representative here to speak on that, and she will come up in just a minute, and you all know who it's going to be, but I'll let her speak to that. But again, Operation Turkey, next Saturday, 9 to noon, I have an update on how well we're doing, but it has to wait for the joys and concerns. So whether or not it is a joy or concern, we'll figure it out then, but stay tuned. Okay, so the 18th, that's the next thing to announce. The 18th, that is a Friday at 7 p.m., we are having a Blue Christmas / Longest Night service. We've called it both things, and a couple people had questions about what it was last week. Well, Christmas, the Advent season, is not always an easy time for some people, even in a good year, especially if you've had a loved one pass or you deal with seasonal depression or issues like that. The season can just feel like kind of a sandpaper on your soul in that regard. People are so happy and festive, and you're not, so you feel left out. Well, the Blue Christmas service, the Longest Night service, is meant for people like that. And I have a feeling there are a lot of us in that boat this year. So if you're feeling out of sorts, angry, irritated, depressed, that Christmas is not what it should be, that you're not connecting to all that's going on, stop on by that service at 7 p.m. on YouTube. We're doing it with our brothers and sisters at First Congregational across the street. And Pastor Tandyway and I recorded it last week, and just a very deep and touching liturgy that I was reading my parts in it, and I'm like, God, this is ministering to my soul. So I know it will definitely minister to many of you. So the 18th, 7 p.m., YouTube. Okay, without further ado, we have our special representative from the Elf Guild. She is here to let us know what is going on with Christmas cookies, assisted living, and all that sort of stuff. So I will summon her. Elf, please join us.
Good morning, all. Yeah, you can't escape the elf, I know. You just don't get to hear me walk up the aisle, that's it. So I'm saying hi to you all. I miss you all a lot. Can't wait till this pandemic's over. But with that being said, as much as you're stuck at home, so is our nursing home friends and our shut-ins from Trinity. So we need your love and care, and that means that the same day as the Operation Turkey, thank you for that, we're also taking your Christmas cards for our members, your cookies and puzzles and magazines. So I'm taking the certain magazines, all of them actually, over to Big Thompson Manor 1 and 2, because they couldn't take cookies, they're taking magazines this year. So that'll give them something to look forward to and be out of their, you know, perspective thought process and be able to enjoy something. Even if it says February, it doesn't matter. All right? So remember, this coming Saturday, from 9 until noon, we are taking cookies, cards, magazines, and anything you want to give to the seniors. And then I want you to come back through on the 19th to pick up your cards. So that'll be a chance for us to still say hi to those friends we haven't got to see all year and make sure that you send your love and your little notes and say, hey, call me. Or, you know, let's do a virtual cup of coffee over the phone. Anyways, so remember, this coming Saturday, we'd love to see you. There'll be quite a few of us here to welcome you. You can stay in your car, keep it in the back of your trunk. You can just pull up, pop the trunk, and we'll empty it for you. You don't even need to get out. So we've got it all handled. If you have any questions, you can call the church. You can call me. How about you, Bryson? You can call Bryson. We all have the dates and the times, and we'll go from there. Can't wait to see you guys. Bye.
Many thank you to the Christmas Elf and all your team is doing. So that has the potential to be really fun next week and then the week after, 9 to noon. Since we're partnering with First Church this Advent season, they've got an invitation to join. I know our millennial small group is trying to figure out some donations to give. This could be a really impactful thing to do in our community in a time of need, so I hope you'll join with us. All right, last announcement concerns the big night, Christmas Eve. We have one service that's officially down and scheduled and one that's in process. 7 p.m. on YouTube, we will have a live stream sort of like this, working the details on that about theming. And then we're trying to have some sort of in-person service in the parking lot. We're hoping to have some fire pits or some space heaters to keep people warm out there. We have to work with the fire marshals on that. So I have a call to them on Monday, and we'll figure this out. So 7 p.m. for sure, 3 p.m. in the parking lot, possibly, hopefully, cross your fingers. Okay? All right, friends, that's it for the business. Now for the worship, the reason we all came here today. Let us open your hearts, your minds, your souls, because the Advent journey renews now. We experienced peace last week. Now we have a moment of hope as we see Christ's light growing stronger in the distance. Let's reflect on that in a time of music, and we'll go into worship.
In hard times, we go searching for a sign. The sun seems to dim. The moon fails. The stars fall. We need a sign, any sign. Be aware, stay awake. Change is coming. We hope that Christ is on the way, gathering the faithful from the four winds. In a place of peace, we need a sign, any sign. Be aware, stay awake, change is coming. Today we search for a sign of the one who is coming. Clarify in confusion, a green shoot in a barren landscape, a song arising in a weary soul. Be aware, stay awake. Change is coming. Amen. Now we light today's Advent candle. In the book of Isaiah, chapter 40, the prophet hears a voice cry out, "You in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken." We hope for this highway to reach us. We long for God's glory to come. So as the voices of children last week kindled the candle of peace, now, Holy One, we light this second flame. May its encouragement shine in the midst of the stories of the last year. Let it burn through these weeks as a beacon to become the light of hope. Let it guide us to your presence in our midst, leading us to your justice and joy in the service of Christ. Join me now in the closing. God be with us in this light of hope. Amen.
Amen indeed. I hope that everybody had a chance to see that on the screen. I tried to configure the feed so you could see Pat and what I was doing to light the candle. So let me know how that worked for you. This is all one great experiment week to week, and so feedback is welcome. As for now, we have a chance to sing some of our loved songs from this time of year. Now, it's got to be said, though, that Methodists traditionally fall into one of two camps when it comes to holiday season carols. You either prefer not to sing Christmas carols until Christmas Eve and after, focusing on the Advent ones in the hymnal, or you say, give me all the Christmas carols you can play every week. More people tend to be in the latter half of that conversation, but I try to honor both sides. Imagine that, me being a moderate. So what I traditionally do is I have one or two Advent carols or one or two Christmas carols in the same service to kind of balance it out. We have that today. Our opening hymn is number 211, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel, which is the consummate Advent carol. It speaks of a longing, a lament, just a frustrated patience waiting for Christ to come. So feel that now, and yet feel that tinge of excitement at the end of that as we sing this one together. O Come, Emmanuel.
Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel.
I think I accidentally hit the wrong button and sent you straight forward into one of the sermon pictures. So that's just a foretaste of what's coming, if you saw that, and I'm guessing you did. All right, so coming to our time of prayer and lifting up of joys and concerns, feel free to put your joys and concerns in the chat box and to lift each other up in the struggles and the joys and whatever life is bringing us right now. So to lift up a couple concerns that came in last week, we are praying fervently for the Leonard family. Regrettably, the COVID bug has popped up in their household. Tyler and then the other son, I forget his name, I apologize, but they are both tested positive and the others are kind of in lockdown with them. So prayers for Megan, Vicky, Larry, and the Leonard clan. We love you and prayers for you to get through this and for healing. Otherwise, we also pray for Judy Denikas' brother and sister-in-law in Iowa. They're having some health problems. And again, please feel free to put in whatever you need lifted up in this sacred season. I'll check the feed real fast. I'm not really seeing much, but then again, we are on a delay. But again, please feel free to submit things. We'll continue to pray for teachers and educators who are feeling a little frayed going into Christmas break. We're praying just for small businesses in our area as conversations intensify. You probably saw between the Reporter Herald in Colorado and that about 70 businesses in our area are having intense discussions with Governor Polis and the government about restrictions because of the downturn in the economy. So we're definitely in prayer for that, how it affects our individual community here. But whatever else we can pray for, please, we lift it up. Now, let's get to the joy slash concern I was mentioning. You'll see why it could be both as you take a look at the Operation Turkey Meter. Dun, dun, dun. Looks like you can see it. And as you can tell, our meter has reached the very top. We haven't even had our second edition of Operation Turkey yet. So that is absolutely outstanding. We meet our weight goal of donations and our cash goals that we're going to give to House of Neighborly Service. And if Debbie Huff is on right now, I would ask her to put the totals exactly because they keep changing because you all keep giving. But this is outstanding. We haven't even gotten to the end of our food drive, our donation drive, and we're already where we need to be, which means we can do even more. That part is certainly the joy. Now, the concern. I said I would dress up like a turkey if we got to that goal. Well, it appears that I either have to keep my word or run for the hills. I don't know which will happen, but if you've seen some of the turkey costume suggestions that have come across my email in the last week, you wouldn't blame me for running for the hills. Now, I'm a man of my word. I will do that in a couple weeks here in worship. You will see the results. Just think of it this way. In the Bible, there's a story about King David dancing and some of his skin gets exposed and people are appalled. And he says, I will be far more undignified than this to praise my God. So that's my mantra in all this. It will definitely be interesting as Operation Turkey concludes. And a big thank you to all who are participating. All right. Quick scan of the chat box. Doesn't say any joys or concerns. Nope. So we'll go ahead and move on. But friends, let's open up ourselves for a time of deep prayer and contemplation. This is the Advent season, the time of waiting, of wondering, of just trying to see the light through so much darkness. Let's do that now. Let's turn our gaze inward towards our soul, to find that small point of light where God's life intersects with ours. And let's watch that life grow as we chat in prayer. Join me. Wonderful Spirit, the Christ child of Bethlehem, we heard news of your coming last week, announced in songs with children dancing in joy. The peace from that is unimaginable. the calm we get knowing that our Savior is on the way, that justice, love, and grace will prevail over anything we're facing is such a just a soothing note in our lives. Now we pray, build on that. As you've cleared out a peaceful place in our souls, build a foundation of hope today, like the candle that burns on our wreath. Light us up with it. Encourage us. May we see your light growing stronger in the distance and a corresponding blaze in our own souls. And in turn, help us to harness that hope that you give us. Let it become that driving power that keeps us going in adversity. Whatever we're facing, God, whatever concerns we brought up to you today, whether it's concerns of sickness, this blasted pandemic that won't go away, economic downturns, fear of the future, whichever one of those areas of darkness is concerning us most, God, let that hope blaze forth in our heart and overcome it. Not our hope, but yours. Not our life, but yours. Your Spirit working with us. And at the same time, we pray, God, we know that hope is a distant thing. It's always out in the future leading us on. So help us to be patient in the present. Help us to endure whatever we're going through today, to find your hope. May we find small instances of joy and light right now that keep us going, that show us that hope is tangible. May it be in the smiles of children, the piles of presents that are under the tree, the gift given to somebody that brings an immense smile, the seeing of a loved one on a screen from miles away. Those instances of hope are different this year, God, but they are hopeful nevertheless, and we thank you for them. We thank you for all you are and all you bring. We lift up glory and praise to your mighty name and for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who is returning again. Now with the choirs of angels, with the hosts of heaven, we join into the unending hymn, the unending praise. We ask to be lifted up as we pray the prayer Jesus taught us, saying, Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. All right, I want to give you a little bit of an introduction to the special music and to the overall Advent theme we're working with a little bit. The special music is from two gentlemen from First Church, Rex Berg and Guy Keith. Is a part of our partnership with our sister congregation in this Advent season, where we're sharing a sermon series, and we're also sharing the songs that the sermons are based off of. So whenever the pastor from one church preaches in this series, a music group from the other will be offering the music. So today, since I'm preaching for both churches, I'm recorded a message which is playing for our brothers and sisters at First Church right now. Since I'm preaching, you get to hear from First Church's musician. Then next week, when Reverend Lee Anderson Harris, and then the week after, when Reverend Steve Goodyear preach, we will have music from our church for both congregations. Kind of a nice sharing arrangement. We get to offer the best of our music and the best of our preaching, hopefully on my end, to this sacred time. So enjoy that now. Our bass hymn today is O Little Town of Bethlehem. So please, may the Spirit of God meet you in this offering.
O little town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie above the dark and dreamless sleep. The silent stars go by, yet in thy dark street shine.
Some carols just lend themselves to small, simple, quiet arrangements, and I think Oh, Little Town of Bethlehem is definitely one of those. So thank you to our sibling musicians at First Church for that wonderful offering. One quick announcement before I launch into the sermon. As you probably saw behind me, we do have communion elements. We are serving drive-through communion, drive-through only in the west parking lot starting at 11 to 11:30. So I'll bless the elements later in worship, and then we'll serve them out there beginning at 11. So hope you can join us. All right. That being said, you may not have gotten this year's Advent theme in the Christmas pageant last week. And that's kind of by design. And during a kids' pageant, there's so much going on, so much joy and action on the screen sometimes. Exactly what you're trying to say get lost, but it was fabulous. So many thanks to Debby and to Anne and to all the people who helped put that one on. But the theme, as you probably got from the, hopefully got from the choir piece that was done, is Christmas carols. We're focusing on one a week, and last week's effort was O Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. Now we continue that focus today, that shared focus between us and our brothers and sisters over at First Church. It's all about Christmas carols, and why not? They are one of, if not the most treasured part of the holiday season. But since this pandemic has prevented us from playing and hearing Christmas carols in their preferred environment, namely the sanctuaries of our churches, since we can't experience them in person with our beloved family in the body of Christ, it might feel like a Christmas carol's power is subdued somewhat. I felt that way. I've been listening to Christmas music a lot, and just knowing that I can't play it here in front of people and worship. We had some carols playing this morning as we set up. It was kind of a hollow feeling around here, for sure. I equate the sensation to watching a TV show on mute with the closed captioning on. Sarah and I did that a lot when Eva was a baby. She would nap in our room, so Sarah and I would turn on a TV program, mainly to keep ourselves awake, to keep Eva asleep as long as possible. We'd kill the volume, pop on the subtitles, and watch away. Anything to prolong that sleep as long as possible. And parents, if you agree with that, give an amen in the chat box. Doing that makes for a vastly different watching experience, however. Instead of hearing the voices of the characters or the music going on in the background of the shot, all you get is pure silence. So to understand what's going on, you have to zoom in and focus on the words as they appear on the screen. You're hanging on every single one. Try it sometime and you'll learn what I did. Without sound, waiting for words, those words get a deeper meaning. Concentrating on them, picking them apart for nuance, you can get more about what's going on in a character's life, in the story that's on the screen, in all the corresponding actions taking place. So that's kind of the approach we're attempting to duplicate in this sermon series. Since the music of our Christmas carols is muted, we're left studying the lyrics and some of the stories we know of these carols' creation. It may not be the full blessed experience that you get when you hear a talented musician perform your favorite version in the church, but you're going to see the lesson is still profoundly impactful. You're definitely going to see what I mean after you learn everything behind today's carol, A Little Town of Bethlehem. Let's start by meeting its writer. This is the picture I accidentally popped up earlier, and I'll pop it up again. It's on your screen. This is him. His name is the Reverend Phillips. That's with an S on the end. Phillips. The Reverend Phillips Brooks. He was born in Boston, Massachusetts in 1835 and was ministering in the city of Philadelphia when this image was taken around 1860. Pop quiz. What major historical event was revving up in America around 1860. I know you're shouting it at the screen right now. I can hear it from here. That's right, the American Civil War. That conflict played a direct role in this Christmas carol's creation. You learn that when you see the context of what happened in that brutal, bloody conflict. Approximately 620,000 people died during it. That equates to roughly 2% of the American population in the 1860s. To show you how brutal that was, if we were to lose a comparable amount in a conflict today, 2% of all current Americans, that total would come to 6.7 million people. Whew. Can you just picture that scope, the damage? 6.7 million people dead in just 4 years? Ponder the widespread effect, that similar effect that was happening in the people back then. I mean, we can put ourselves in their shoes. If we were dealing with such a conflict now, how many of those casualties would be people you love? Wars, they overwhelmingly affect the young. So how many of your kids and grandkids would be on the casualty lists? Decimation was everywhere after this war, during it too. Communities, whole communities were hollowed out. People were left feeling gutted by the experience. And Reverend Brooks knew all those feelings. He was rector or the lead pastor of Philadelphia's Episcopal Church of the Holy Trinity. From that position, he watched many of his congregation join the Union Army. Then as the battles were fought and casualty lists started coming in, Brooks found himself increasingly ministering to mothers who'd lost their sons, wives who'd lost their husbands, families who were now desperately poor without a breadwinner. He himself lost a brother in the war in 1862, so Reverend Brooks knew it firsthand. Death was everywhere. By the end of the war, Brooks is said to have preached 150 or more military funerals. And there were countless more he couldn't do because the bodies were never recovered. These conditions made for just a tough, rough 4 years in America. But by April of 1865, there seemed to be some hope on the horizon. Robert E. Lee's army surrendered at Appomattox, so it appeared the national nightmare was coming to an end. That feeling was short-lived because a few days after the surrender, April 14th, President Abraham Lincoln went to a play at Ford's Theater in Washington, D.C., where, as many of you probably remember, he was assassinated by John Wilkes Booth. Lincoln's death hit America hard. Brooks was hit hard by it. Yet there was no time for him to grieve because a few days after learning of Lincoln's death, an envoy arrived from the White House. Since Brooks was the lead pastor at the biggest church in town and one of the best preachers in the area, the government asked if he would lead the public memorial service for Lincoln when the funeral train came through Philadelphia. Brooks accepted, and by all accounts, he wrote a masterful message for that memorial service. He preached it in front of several thousand people. Doing that, though, broke him. Everything Phillips Brooks had gone through in the last 4 years welled up in him as he gave that message. He found himself not able to deal with the grief, the anger, and the uncertainty. So Brooks requested an immediate leave of absence from his pulpit. Then he went and hopped on a ship. He wanted to get away as far away from America as possible. He went to Europe. Soon he decided to go back to where the story of Christ began, Bethlehem. Brooks thought that if he sought out God at the source, perhaps he could figure some things out. Maybe he'd get some answers to his questions. Arriving in December of 1865, Brooks attended Christmas Eve at the Church of the Nativity, the place where Jesus is thought to have been born. Sitting there in that long mass, that long service, the tired, exhausted rector felt something. He'd been so distant from God, surrounded by the darkness of death. Yet here, the divine was so near. The spirit was palpable in the songs of praise coming up from the worshipers, from the prayers being offered in this most sacred shrine. It led to a powerful revival experience for Brooks. And if you've ever had a similar one, you know. You feel feelings of elation. You're happy and whole. You feel like yourself for the first time in ages. That's what Brooks was experiencing. And heading back out to his campsite on the hillside, because you couldn't stay in Bethlehem during Christmas Eve, there are too many pilgrims, so you had to camp on the hillsides outside of town. While he was there on the hillsides during the middle of the night, he happened to see shepherds with their sheep. The shepherds were watching their flocks by night, much like their ancestors had done that very night Christ was born. That made the moment complete. Brooks felt God right next to him, God was in Bethlehem and with him on that holy night. Thus restored, Brooks soon left and returned to America, back to his church. He was a completely changed man. 3 years later, in 1868, the experience was still singing in his soul, as he would tell people. So Brooks decided 1 year to write a carol about it. His church organist, Lewis Redner, composed the tune, and O Little Town of Bethlehem was initially presented at the Church of the Holy Trinity Christmas pageant children's program in 1868, which is highly appropriate considering how many Christmas pageants it's been in ever since. So that's the story of how we got O Little Town of Bethlehem. Whew, what a roller coaster, right? Anybody feel the sledgehammer of emotions hitting you during it? Some good stuff there. And doesn't it open your eyes to the lyrics Brooks wrote? Yet in thy dark streets shineth the everlasting light, the hopes and fears, I know you're singing it with me, of all the years are met in thee tonight. Brooks brought some profound fears to Bethlehem, didn't he? He was exhausted, war-weary, battling faith questions, and dealing with personal hurts on top of everything else. Yet in Bethlehem, he encountered a hope that overcame it all, a divine peace that restored him to life. Could any of us use that as Christmas approaches this year? Renewed peace, a rested soul, a clearer perspective, or hope in general? That is today's Advent theme, after all. Could any of you use that? Type yes in the box if you could use that. I'm guessing everybody could if you wanted. It's such an easy question to answer. Of course we need these things. We aren't dealing with the aftermath of a civil war right now, but the factors Phillips Brooks was going through, we're dealing with them in some form and fashion. I don't need to tell you this, but people are tired right now. Communities are scared. Death is this ever-looming presence as we see COVID rates increase, as we hear reports of those who have died on a particular day, as we learn the stories of our healthcare workers and what they're dealing with. We are in the middle of that. So can something like what happened to Reverend Brooks still happen to us? Can we find a holy moment in Bethlehem here in a few weeks? A sacred time when the morning stars together proclaim the holy birth, and praises sing to God the King, and peace to men on earth. We can find it, but how do we get there? What do we do? Well, I don't think the words of the carols tell us, but the example of Phillips Brooks sure does. From his journey in creating O Little Town of Bethlehem, we can see the key to unlocking God's Christmas hope is being patient. I'll say it again. That's the bedrock of the message today. The key to unlocking God's Christmas hope is being patient. That may not sound quite right to some of us because we may be not good with patience, or we might picture what the world considers to be patient. When we think of patience, we don't automatically picture somebody like Phillips Brooks, who a poor soul who's had the world fall on his shoulders. When we think of patience, we see somebody in our head like somebody who's waiting in one of those mammoth lines at King Supers in the holiday season. You know the one line they have to snake all the way around the store because everybody's in it? That's the one I'm talking about. But this person's cool, calm, not a thing wrong with them as they stand in that. Or it's the person who's in the doctor's office, carelessly reading a magazine, even though they have a hernia check in 15 minutes. You don't see a trace of that anxiety on their face. They are a calm customer. One of the definitions I found on an online dictionary of patience sums this up very well. It said, patience is the ability to accept or tolerate delay, trouble, or problems without getting angry or upset. That sound about right to you? Patience is basically self-restraint. Yeah, pretty good definition. So how does that make Phillips Brooks patient at all? By any measure of this definition, he's completely impatient. I mean, people who storm off to the Holy Land in the middle of an existential crisis, they don't seem to qualify. I know it doesn't seem like it, but I assure you, Brooks is as patient as they come. That's because he operates by a different definition than you'll see in any dictionary. I thought the theologian Henry Nouwen nailed it when he once wrote, patience is the means and willingness to stay where we are and live the situation out to the full in the belief that something hidden there will manifest itself to us. Staying where we are, living our situation in full in the hope that something will happen. That's true patience. As we've heard today, that means you might have to stay in some really rough circumstances. Those can feel especially long when you're waiting on God to do something, when you're praying every night, God, help me, show me the way. The people the Apostle Peter is writing about in our scripture definitely are feeling this way, and I just realized I did not read the scripture today. We had an error between Pat Jones and I did not record the scripture, but I'll go ahead and read it now. The scripture's out of 2 Peter, verses 3, 8 through 15. Gotta love live worship. You get to interrupt like this. But in that one, Peter writes, you must not forget this one thing, dear friends. A day is like 1,000 years to the Lord, and 1,000 years is like a day. The Lord isn't really being slow about his promise, as some people think. No, he's being patient for your sake. He does not want anyone to be destroyed, but wants everyone to repent. But the day of the Lord will come unexpectedly as a thief in the night. Then the heavens will pass away with terrible noise, and the elements themselves will disappear in fire. And the earth and everything in it will be found to deserve judgment. Since everything around us will end up like this, what holy and godly lives should you live now? Looking forward to the day of God and hurrying it along. On that day, he will set the heavens on fire. The elements will melt away in flames. But we will be looking forward to the new heavens and the new earth as he has promised, a world filled with God's righteousness. And so, dear friends, while you are being patient for these things to happen, make every effort to be found living peaceful lives that are pure and blameless in his sight. And remember, our Lord's patience gives people time to be saved. So that is the word of God for the people of God. And a retroactive thanks be to God. So that was the letter the Apostle Peter sent out. And it encountered a church that was abuzz with questions that he was trying to answer. Our ancient forebears were wondering, when is Jesus going to come and sort all this out? We know he's going to bring perfect peace, love, and justice to bear on the world. When's it going to be? I mean, in Matthew 24, 34, Jesus himself says, this generation's not going to pass away before all these things take place. The problem is, God operates on God's own schedule. That's what verse 8 says in our reading. A day is like 1,000 years to the Lord, and 1,000 years is like a day. Yet Peter is quick to assure us, the Lord isn't really being slow about his promise. He is being patient for your sake. There's that word again, patience. And isn't it interesting that God is the one being patient with us, just as we are being patient with the divine? God wants to give us what is promised, but he also wants to give God or people as much time to find salvation as possible. God's definitely got a longer-term view on things than we do, don't you think? Plus, it's not like God is sitting around in the divine easy chair just waiting for all this to take place. The patience God shows us, and the one we're supposed to show in return, it's an active force that often leads us into hardship. You learn this when you discover the original Greek term for patience that we see in verses 9 and 15 of our reading today. The Greek there is the term macrothumia. In other parts of the scripture, it translates as long-suffering or sort of painful endurance. I hope everything's starting to click now. Patience as long-suffering, as patient endurance. This is just like Henry Nouwen said. It's being willing to stay in a hard situation in the belief that something good will manifest. And that, in turn, is the baseline of hope, the ignition of hope. Friends, this explains Phillips Brooks so perfectly, doesn't it? His patience was the foundation for his hope. And in turn, it sheds a new light on God's character. Since God is showing us macrothumia, that patient endurance, that suffering patience, we learn that the divine is not just simply standing by while people are hurting. No, God's in it with us. God has a bright future hope and dream ready to go. But he's also come down to us in the flesh to meet us and show us the way to that dream. There's a reason why one of Jesus' many titles is Emmanuel, God with us. And this is it. Christmas is about how God comes in flesh to be with creation. Jesus' birth, life, death, and resurrection show us everything we will be waiting for patiently. And to see that, to realize that, to learn it, we need to continue drawing near to Christ's birthplace, as Reverend Brooks did. That's what Advent calls us to do. And if we can continue and learn the lesson he did, we'll learn all that Brooks felt that night. It's not easy. Like Brooks meant, you have to stay in the struggle. You can't bypass it to get to the end. The heavens might be on fire, all the elements of the world might be melting in flames, and that describes the effects of the Civil War pretty well, I think. That's what Peter wrote. Brooks endured that, and he kept looking forward to the new heavens and the new earth right in the middle of that. We can do the same. Knowing Christ meets us at Christmas can give us that profound hope. Until then, it's up to us to make that hope as productive as possible. That's what Peter means when he writes, "While you are waiting for these things to happen, make every effort to be found living peaceful and pure, blameless lives in God's sight." So that gives us a bunch of things to ponder as we wrap up now. What fears, what hurts, what experiences are we bringing to Bethlehem this year? You know those. Now, what hope do you need God to show you in response? Then, between then and now, what pure and blameless living can you do? What ministry can you take part in? How can you serve others? This is a time of year where there are opportunities that are many and multiple for that. I've gotten emails from our partners at the Salvation Army. They're looking for bell ringers this year. If you're looking for something to do, if you feel comfortable to that. I know the Salvation Army's hurting a little bit. They've gotten half the donations they have normally got by this time of year, so it might be good to help them out. I interviewed Glory Magrum for our podcast, the Loveland Strong podcast, and if you listen to that interview, you know that HNS, House of Neighborly Service, is bustling busy right now. In July, their service usage went up 1,500%. They're up, what did she say, 65% year to date. I tried to talk to her to get her to come back on to do an interview about what they're doing going into Christmas, but Lori Magrum was so busy, she said, I'm sorry, I can't. You can help with that by responding to Operation Turkey next week, by just dropping off donations at H&S. Friends, if you look for a way to live a blameless life, to be productively patient, you'll find it. Do that. We're also gathering reading material for assisted living. We're doing so many things right now, baking cookies. What can you do to be patiently productive? You can do anything God shows you, or anything I've told you, anything where the Spirit is leading. Whatever you find, it keeps you moving on the journey. It makes your patience productive, even though it's a long-suffering one. And in the end, it will draw you close to the little child of Bethlehem, the hope we see growing in the distance. So we continue that journey now. We pray as we end in prayer. Would you join me, please? Gracious God, descend to us, we pray. Enter in. Be born with us, we pray. Help us to see our own journeys, much like Reverend Brooks. We are experiencing difficulties. We're experiencing hardship. But the peace that comes from your presence can lead us to hope if we continue to search for you. So power us wherever we are. Send us forward towards Bethlehem so we might meet your Son and be renewed by his grace as Christmas comes to us. Let us be productively patient till then and blessed in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. One of the things Jesus did for his followers was to give them a little boost along the way, that little bit of oomph towards hope. A good meal does that for people. And he did that in the sacrament of Holy Communion. This is a physical, spiritual, mental, a complete boost from our God and Father. So we remember that today, and I hope to see you outside when we celebrate here in a little bit. We're running a little behind, so sorry, the Spirit's just preaching a little long today, but we remember that night when Jesus took bread, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, take and eat. This is my body that's broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And after the supper was over, he took the cup. And again, he blessed it. And he gave it to his disciples and said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. So in remembrance of these God's mighty acts, the birth of a Savior at Christmas, the return of a Savior at someday in the future, and all the glorious lessons and life that's in between, we pray, thank you for this Spirit, and we ask that you would come down and bless these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Jesus Christ, broken that we would be made whole, sacrificed that we would know plenty, given to one to be given to all, the original Christmas gift. We thank you for that gift, your presence in our lives. May it redeem, sustain, and send us out to create new life. In your name we pray. Amen. Again, folks, we'll have that out in the west parking lot here in a little bit. Give us about 10 minutes to set up. So I'd say we'll kind of go from about 11:15 to 11:45-ish. We appreciate your flexibility. Otherwise, if you do have a tithe or offering today, feel free to head on over to the church website and click on the online giving to provide it there, or continue to mail in your checks. We are thankful for that. For now, though, we celebrate with song once more. Since we've had an Advent carol, we're now going to end with our first official Christmas carol of the season here at Trinity. This one's one many of you love. It's It Came Upon a Midnight Clear. So celebrate and find the hope, the light that's in that midnight clear as we sing. Thank you.
from angels bending near the earth to touch their harps of gold. Peace on the earth, goodwill to men, from heaven's all gracious King. The world in solemn stillness lay to hear the angels sing. Still through the cloven skies they come with peaceful wings unfurled, and still their heavenly music floats o'er all the weary world. Above its sad and lonely plains they bend on hovering wing, and ever o'er its babble sounds the blessed angels sing. And ye beneath life's crushing load, where forms are bending low, who toil along the climbing way with painful steps and slow, look now for glad and golden hours come swiftly on the wing. And lost beside the weary road, and hear the angels sing. For lo, the days are hastening on, by prophet seen of old, when with the ever-circling years shall come the time foretold, when peace shall over all the earth its ancient splendors fling, and the whole world send back the song which now the angels sing.
Amen, friends. Come now to our final blessing. And before I do, just one quick thing. Again, there's a lot going on, and I have to remind you of it. The 18th, that is a Saturday at 3 p.m. in the afternoon, we have our charge conference. That's our annual administrative meeting where we set our slate of leaders. We may approve our budget, and we get to connect with our district superintendent. That'll be via Zoom. If you'd like the link for that, please message me. So the 18th, that's your two-week notice as required by the Book of Discipline. All right. As for our benediction, I got a small, quick story for you. It's about Billy Graham. He was driving to one of his rural camp meetings in Appalachia one night with his wife, where they came across a stretch of road that was under construction. Now, if you've ever driven that area of the world, you know it's really tight curves. It's one-lane highways. There were several near misses for the Grahams that night as they tried to find this revival meeting he was supposed to preach at. This construction with everything was just wearing them thin until finally they came to the end of it. Finally, they saw the end of this construction period. Once they got past it, there was a giant sign there. And Ruth Graham, Billy's wife, said this: "I want the words of that sign to be on my tombstone." And what were those words? "End of construction. Thanks for your patience." Friends, I'm thankful for your patience with the community today, and God is thankful for our patience, and we are thankful for God's patience. May we continue to be patient and to find hope in the middle of that, and go forth and show that to the world. And go forth blessed in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We'll see you outside shortly. Amen.